soap. Getting into God's word. Going where you've never gone before spiritually. Scripture, observation, application, prayer. Today is a soap study. And you're going with me on this journey because we've been using our soap. And I am the person who's going to be giving it to you today. And I love you. I know, you're probably sitting there going, really? Really? Hey, you got to do something. But we've been going through this year with our soap journal. And today, I wanted to really post this because, boy, this one was a real personal one for me. And so we read today, Job 1 through 2. You should have your cards and we're reading along. And Acts 6 through 7. And I entitled this, When I Feel Like I Am Being Picked On by God. Woo! There's a title for you. And so here's the scripture verse. My scripture was Job 1, 21 through 22. And he said, Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked shall I return. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this, Job did not sin or charge God with wrong. Boy, that's huge. So here's my observation. Of course, you know I always give you context because that's what I do for myself. The book of Job is the first of what we call the poetical books of the Bible. Throughout the Old Testament, there's poetry. Some examples of this are seen in the use of language describing blessings and curses. In Genesis 49, 2 through 27, as well as certain historical accounts as Exodus 15, 1 through 18, and the dirges of 2 Samuel 1, 19 through 27. Those are not a pick-me-up, by the way, if you've ever read them before. The poetry of the Old Testament is very different from what we are exposed to in our contemporary cultural context. It involves not the rhyming of sounds, but instead the rhyming of concepts, thoughts, and ideas. Scholars use this term parallelism to describe the structure of this type of Old Testament literature. For the most part, parallelism may be either antithetical, where the thoughts are opposite from one another. There is no mention of who the author is, and the scholars are split on this point. Some stating that they think it's Solomon because of the vast knowledge of foreign countries and cultures. And I tend to agree with the scholars who believe that Moses is the author, because Moses, while he was in Egypt, had gained a vast knowledge of other cultures and what have you, and countries. And many of the words and phrases that are used in the Pentateuch are used throughout the book of Job. There's phrases that are used that I think are very much Moses. Furthermore, the land of Uz was adjacent to Midian, where Moses spent 40 years prior to his return to Egypt. And for me, there's also an extra biblical framework that points to Moses, and that is Moses was exposed to some of the concepts that we find dealing with the mystery of the spiritual realm, like in Enoch and Jubilees, that are extra biblical, that frames some of the understanding of Satan and his actions and his influence in human history. That's a whole other conversation, but those are some of the arguments that I have personally concerning the book. The purpose of the book is to show how the unfathomable wisdom of God's providence and benevolence of God, even in trials, are brought upon his children. It also explains why God allows righteous people to suffer and to expose their frailty and sinfulness and to strengthen their faith and to purify them. The spiritual perspective is really important with this on the account. The fact that God exercised total control over Satan promotes that we can have complete trust in God. Because, man, you know, we have a very Hollywood version of Satan, you know, and Satan is not on equal with God. He's a fallen angel that is fallen. He's a created being that was created by the Creator. Very important. We don't put him on equal footing as God. In this section, we are told in the very first verse of the chapter 1 that there's a man in the land of Uz whose name is Job, and that he was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil. He was a man of wealth, and he does not know that behind the cosmic scene, Satan is before God, and it is here that God gives permission for Satan to test Job. He could do anything but kill Job. A series of events happen that are horrific. First, his sheep are burned up. Second, the Chaldeans raid his land and rob him of his animals and kill his children. Job reacts and mourns at these events and tears off his garments in grief, but he declares that he came into this world with nothing, and he will leave this world with nothing. And in verse 22, here are the words that speak to the character of Job. In all this, Job did not sin or charge God with wrong. And this leads me to my personal application. I read this declaration from Job and this description of what he did not do. Keep in mind that he knows nothing, like me and you, in our own lives, of what is happening behind the scenes in heavenly places. It's not like Job knows the script. He is simply living life, and this great test is given him, and he's the recipient of this test. In chapter 2, his own wife declares to him, "Curse God and die." Wow, there's a pick-me-up. Most Christians live a life grounded in some false sense of entitlement that places them in their own created comfort zone. It has been my own experience that whether we struggle with our own family of origin, we tend to seek our own created form of heaven on earth, and we are good with God and others as long as they, God and others, do not rock our good ship comfort zone. Boy, that's me. I have lived this with my difficult transition from my previous church to how I came here to New Hope Fellowship. I was hurt and angry with God and others, but in the sovereignty of God, he had a better plan for me. The people of my previous church are not bad or evil. They love Jesus and God had a plan for the people in my previous church, and he had a plan for me. God in his sovereignty works out something for everybody. Sometimes I want to slip back and blame others for what happened, but really the same God that is working in me is working on in them. And in all truth, it takes away my focus being on what Jesus has done for me. Man, if I get caught up in all that noise, and I love where I'm at today, and I love all those on my journey who have helped me they've helped me become more like Christ, because God knows I have not arrived. If you focus on yesterday's challenges that were out of your control, it will rob you of the ability and the joy to celebrate today's blessings. And you get to do, and here's what the thing, and who you get to do it with, right? We celebrate that, and that will steal your passion. Passion can only be taken from us if we relinquish we lay it down. Our discernment of others will become skewed, as well as we will become nitpicky and negative of others. Matter of fact, I've seen people obsess, and I obsess over it. You obsess over someone else, and it's a lie. Get off it. Stop it. Job did not give place to this, and I don't want to give place to this in my life, and I do at times. At times, I want to resort back to the old, and I want to focus on God, what God's doing in my yesterday rather than focus on my today. And I want to speak blessings on people today. I don't want to get caught up in all that. I want to be able to bless people wherever they are, regardless on their continuum. And so here was my prayer for today. I want you to catch this. My prayer for today is, our Father who is in heaven, I pray that I would come into a place of not seeking my rightness or need of justice on my terms, which robs me of how you have worked amid every challenging life situation to get me to a place where I am today. Help me to be a person that leans into your wisdom and revelation and not lean on my own understanding. May I always be the best tool in your hands with my body, soul, and spirit. I pray this in Jesus' name. Man, you know what? Things happen in our lives. Decisions are made. The courses. And we can get bitter and caught up in that and blame and feel like somehow a bad thing happened. And I'm telling you, God is a God who recycles everything. I remember Rick Warren saying that years ago, and it's true. And he uses it all for his glory, for his purpose, so that we can come to the place where we need to be. And I'm at the place where I need to be today, and it is sovereignty. And has life become easier? No. There's all kinds of challenges happening, but I get to lean into the wisdom and knowledge of God and not my own wisdom. And when our decisions become dictated by what we discern is right and wrong on our terms, and we begin to do things to navigate around things, that's not God. That's not God. And I'm being real strong about that this morning. God, forgive us for all of the coping mechanisms we lean into that don't allow us to confront your truth, which sets us free. That's what I'm going to say today. I love you. May Jesus guide your hearts, and may you be well aware that he is for you and not against you. God bless you.